This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. For this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. Alive, alive, alive forevermore. My Jesus is alive, alive forevermore. Alive, alive, alive forevermore. My Jesus is alive. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. My Jesus is alive forevermore. Sing hallelujah, my Jesus is alive. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. Oh, he has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. Good morning and welcome, everybody. It's good to be together. We'll now have the announcements.
Good morning to everybody. It's certainly wonderful to see you all this morning. These couple of long weekends that's around now, there's a number of our people that are gone. This long weekend and next long weekend, there's a lot of people that are going away and have already gone away. It's also school holidays as well. But welcome to you all. It's wonderful to have you with us. A big, big welcome to Fred and Elfriede Bergh. It's wonderful to have you two with us. And also Marcell and Lucia and their son as well. It's wonderful to have you with us. And then some more visitors, Nembus, the aunt of Lee, is also visiting with us today. And also Ina's sister, Ina is a sister of Queen Chavalala. It's also good to have you visiting with us as well. There's a number of birthdays that's coming up this week. Please get your bulletin. I know on Thursday is Emma Lebrier's birthday, 13th birthday, which is a big birthday. So we hope that she will have a wonderful birthday today. Please continue to keep a number of our people in your prayers. Teresa Nakumbule, and also Felicia's mom. She was readmitted into hospital. And continue to keep Denise Smith and also Tini Greef and also Lech van Druten in your prayers as well. Please get the list. There's a number of people that we have to continually keep in our prayers. This morning, as we welcome Marcell, he's going to be bringing the lesson to us, and we certainly look forward to his lesson this morning. And at the Lord's table, Joseph will be directing us at the table, and Theo Rappard will be leading us in the singing. I'm going to call on Sean now to lead us in an opening prayer, and then we'll start.
Please pray with me. Almighty God, we come before you today in humility and faith. We thank you for all you have given us and the many blessings in our lives. We ask for your guidance and strength. Show us the way and fill us with courage and wisdom. Help us to remember your love and grace and to be faithful in our service to you. Give us the patience and understanding to face life's challenges. Father, without your power, we can do nothing. We pray that your glory continues to full and radiate within our lives, Thank you for allowing us the opportunity to be in your presence once again. Father, we give you praise and thanks, for you alone are worthy. At this time, we are mindful of those who are in need of your healing hand. We think of Lej van Druten, Donna and Al Horn, Glenda Fakale, Linda King, and Lisha Karune. Father, we ask that you grant each and every one an awareness of your presence. In all pain and weariness, teach us to yield ourselves to your never-failing care, knowing that your love and power surrounds us. Trusting in your wisdom and providence to give us health and strength. Father, we ask that you manifest your glory and shine your light on each and every one of us. This we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
The numbers for the songs this morning are on the board. Our first one is number 29.
Beautiful robe so white, beautiful land of light, beautiful home so bright, where there shall come no night. Beautiful crown of oil, shining and bright on there, yonder in mansion fair, yonder are there. Beautiful robes, beautiful land, beautiful home, beautiful band, beautiful crown shining so fair, beautiful mansion bright, gather us there. Beautiful thought to me, we shall forever be, but in eternity, when from this world we're free, free from its all and care, heavenly joys to share, let me cross over there, this is my prayer. Beautiful rose, beautiful land, beautiful home, beautiful band, beautiful crown, shining so fair, beautiful mansion bright, gather us there. Beautiful things on high, over in yonder sky, thus I shall leave this shore, counting my treasures all, where we shall never die, carry me by and by, never to sorrow more, heavenly store. Beautiful robes, beautiful land, beautiful home, beautiful band, beautiful crown, shining so fair, beautiful mansion bright, gather us there.
277. Altos, please sing out in the chorus.
As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me, leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, dear Lord, each day, to help me do the best I can. For I need thy light, who guide me day and night, blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Yes, I need thee every hour, through this land, this pilgrim land, my saving power, hear my plea. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Let me travel in the light divine, that I may see the blessed way. Redemption on someday, I will be a soldier brave, and so whenever firmly take a stand, as I onward go and daily meet the foe, blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Yes, I need thee every hour. Through this land, this pilgrim land, my saving power. Hear my plea, my feeble plea. Lord, dear Lord, look down on me when I kneel in prayer. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. When I wander through the valley dim toward the setting of the sun, lead me safely to a land of rest, by a crown of life at one. May reach the golden strand. There's no other friend on whom I can depend. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Yes, I need thee every hour. Through this land, this pilgrim land, my saving power. Hear my plea, my feeble plea. Lord, dear Lord, look down on me when I kneel in prayer. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
After this morning's lesson number 691, excuse me, and before the Lord's table number 387.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously safe from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where he took me in. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. O precious fountain that saves from sin, I am so glad I have entered in. There Jesus saves me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name.
Morning, the church. Okay. Thank you very much for the leaders and as well as everyone that we are all here today worshiping the Lord. As we're going to do the Lord's Supper, our mind needs to focus to Jesus Christ. I think this is a time where we remember his death, the burial, and the resurrection at the same time. But at the moment, the most important, we need to look at his suffering. Because Jesus suffered for us. And because of his love he had toward us. And he is still loving us. That's why today we call ourselves Christians. In the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 11, from verse 23, for I have received of the Lord, for I have received of the Lord that which also I do receive into you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take it, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do it in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, which he had said, this is a cup, is in the new covenant, in my blood, which do it as often as you drink in remembrance of me. So we know that the most important is to remember, because we people, we forget. But each time when we come on the first day of the week, we need to remember. That's why we do the Lord's Supper. We partake on the Lord's Supper. Because it's a time where our focus goes back to the cross and see that, yes, Jesus suffered for us. We'll ask a brother to pray for the bread.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful morning that you've blessed us with. Father, we remember at this time your Son and the sacrifice that he paid on that cross. We remember your great love that he had for us as he walked on this earth, as he died on that cross, so that whoever believes in him and lives that faithful life one day has the hope of eternal life. Even as he sits there, the right hand of the Father, we know that he still cares just as much as he walked on this earth. Help us at this time to focus our minds and realize what a great sacrifice he made, and to live our lives in a manner that is worthy, so that one day you will consider us into heaven, Father. We ask that you will bless the bread that symbolizes his body that suffered on that cross. Bless everyone as we partake of it, and we ask all this through the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Most gracious and heavenly Father, as we partake of the fruit of the vine, which is a symbol of your blood, we echo the words of this morning's Bible study, Father. Father, we reflect on the pain, the suffering, and the humiliation that Jesus went through willingly for us, Father, an unworthy servant. Father, at this time, while partaking, we ask that we reflect on your death, your burial, and your resurrection, and that we do so in a manner that is pleasing to you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
This concludes the Lord's Supper. Now we are in another part, which is giving. First of all, we know that for all of us to be here, it means we have already given our body to Christ, and which is good. But there is also a lot which we can also do, because we need to know that there is a lot of needy within the church and also outside the church. So all the time we need also to think about that. And another part, we know that God blessed us with so many things. Some of us, we got our own businesses. Some of us, we're working. All these things, we need to thank God. He doesn't need everything, but only a portion of it. Let us pray before we give. Thank you, Father, for giving us the opportunity that we are all here worshiping freely. And also, Father, we know that you blessed us with so many things. Father, it's also a time that you help us, teach us that we must be people which we always want to give back. Help others in time of needs, Father. Father, also bless each and everyone who are going to give, and those people who have already given. Father, also, Father, help to those people who are struggling, who can't find the job. Father, that they give them something so that they can help their families. Father, we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
This time our visiting preacher, Brother Marcell, will come and speak the word to us. Please come and preach the word, my brother. Thank you.
Can you hear me now? Yes, great. Good morning, brethren. It's really an honor and privilege to be able to be here. Thank you, Ben, for calling me up. I wouldn't have come, wasn't sure. And you don't want to come up and them say, please go sit down again. You don't want that. It's on very loud. I hope that's okay. Okay. so I don't have to raise my voice. And actually, God knows if I'd have to raise it more. So it's always an honor and a privilege to be able to be here, and I thank you again for the opportunity, the leadership of the congregation, the elders in particular, for an opportunity to share a portion of God's word with you. I'd like you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew, the 13th chapter. So Bruce asked me what the title of the lesson was, and I could see he kind of phased out halfway through my title. And the title of the lesson was, Does the Lesson Ever Apply to Me? Does the lesson ever apply to me? Matthew chapter 13 from verse 1. That same day Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea, and great crowds gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, A sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. And other seeds fell on good soil and produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. So we read here of the parable of the soils, the parable of the sower, but the parable of the soils is probably a better way to describe it, because it's there that we find our greatest lessons. Jesus was most likely in Capernaum, and we see in verse 2 that he actually, if we just read verse 2 again, great crowds gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole crowd stood on the beach. And it was, when I was younger, I couldn't really understand how this would happen, because I had in my mind Durban North Beach or Mschlange Beach or some beach where Jesus got out onto a boat just beyond the breakers and then tried to speak to the people on the shore. And I could not understand. I couldn't reconcile this in my own mind. How on earth would they hear him, right? But you see, that's the wrong picture. That's not what happened at all. So can I ask for you just to put up those, just the first slide. Okay, so you can see that. So you can see that Jesus was in Capernaum, right, which is at the top. If you can't read it from the back, don't worry. You'll just see that there's a little cove, little indentation, little amphitheater, right, which is a perfect amphitheater. It forms literally a perfect amphitheater. If you just push out a little bit, this is a very small map. And we'll see in the second photo, but don't put it up yet, that you can push out with a boat just a few feet, and the people can stand on the shore with the Sea of Galilee pretty calm. He wouldn't have obviously gone out in a storm, and they can hear him. That's amazing, isn't it? How the Word of God is true and never tries to prove itself. It is just true to those who are willing and able to actually research it. It is unapologetically reliable and perfect. So if you just go to the second one, we'll just keep it on there. So that's actually a close-up photo of the cove. Isn't that amazing? I don't know. Just you may have seen this 100 times, but it just blows my mind every time I see this. That's where Jesus would have put his boat, and they can all be around him. You see how the Word of God, it's just perfect and pure, and it doesn't go out there to try and say, this is how perfect and pure I am. It is just there for those who are willing and able to actually bother to look. So, we often explain this parable as the Word of God that God, or the Word of God that is sown, and that Word of God is the gospel. And that as we go out, and as the sower, in this place, the Son of Man, Jesus, goes out and sows the seed, that good seed, and by extension, anyone else who proclaims the Lord, the Word of the Lord, would be an authentic extension of that, right? So, in other words, anyone who proclaims the Word of God sows the seed. And it's the gospel in our mind. And that is correct. I mean, that is the correct interpretation. Philemon 4-6 says, I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith you have towards the Lord Jesus, and for all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith, this is verse 6, is critical. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective to the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. The sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing which is in us for the sake of Christ. For us to gain a full understanding of every good thing that is in Christ, we need to be sharing our faith. And let's just unpack that for a second before we continue. Now, I know that the context here is talking of generosity, and there was a gift, and he was appealing on behalf of Onesimus. But and there's a partnership and a generosity that is spoken of in this particular passage, and that is actually the context. But that the sharing of our faith, I would say, involves more than that. It involves telling others about the hope that is within us, is it not? Because that's what makes our faith special. So it's only by sharing, and this must sink in, it's only by sharing our faith that we get to understand or get to become or get to a fuller knowledge of the Word or of Christ by sharing our faith. What does that say if we're not sharing our faith? We're not reaching that point. Why do we think that is? Well, obviously it's a priority of God that we share our faith. We need to be telling others about the hope. Jesus, well put this morning in the Bible study, excellent Bible study. I would encourage anyone whose opportunity to attend a Bible study to attend a Bible study, because you learn, you listen, you learn, you grow your faith. Excellent Bible study this morning, talking about the cross, talking about the people around the cross. The point is that it was a priority of God, for us to tell people about the cross, about the hope of the gospel. That's one of his priorities. Of course it is. Otherwise, why would he send Jesus to die on the cross if it's not a priority? But it's more than that, I believe, right? Or in addition to that. And that is that when we spread the gospel, when you are telling someone else about your faith, when you're telling someone else about the hope that is within you, it on a very basic and a very high level, on a nuts and bolts and on a very high, deep spiritual level, makes you encounter the gospel and helps you and me to understand the gospel more fully and get to fully understand the power of the gospel that can change lives. You cannot always see that if you just study a textbook or if you just study. You could spend hours studying the gospel, and we need to do that, but it's by practicing it. It's by sharing your faith. It's by sitting across from someone and trying to convince them, tell them, sharing your faith, not because you're selling a product, but because you really want to tell them about the hope that is within you. Then you get to a full knowledge of what is being spoken about here. And allow me for a moment then to punt the college, because that's exactly what the college is about. The Bible College is about getting people out there to do exactly that. No real other reason, actually. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, from verse 22 and 23, the Bible says, "To the weak I have become weak, that I may win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I may save some. I do all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings." Do you see that there is a blessing even for those who preach the gospel here? It's not only about those who benefit from the gospel because they hear they can be saved. I mean, what bigger benefit do you want? But there's a benefit in preaching the gospel, Paul says. We share in all its blessings. And once again, I'm going to turn that on its head and say, if we're not spreading the word of God, then we do not have a full understanding of every good thing that is in Christ, and we do not share in its blessings. If we want to be the best we can be, if we want to reach our full potential as Christians, we have to preach the gospel. And it's not only about, well, you know, it's one of the things on the list. No, it's about God telling us that if we don't, we won't reach that full understanding. We won't reach that potential. Hear the word of God, not me. We won't. Not you might. Not you'll find another way. You won't. So if you're sitting there, if I'm sitting here or standing here this morning going, I can't seem to make this work, it's not happening, or maybe one of the reasons is we're not sharing our faith the way we should. But having said all of that, I want us to approach the parable of the sower this morning, not differently, this is not new at all, but from the perspective rather of the Word of God coming to you and me, not only from the perspective of someone who has not heard the word of God before. Do you see the subtle difference? In other words, when you and I encounter the word of God, because I want to speak to you and I want you to speak to me through me speaking to you, if you understand, right? We're all listening to this morning. So it's not only about someone hearing the gospel for the first time. Whenever you encounter the word of God, I want us to see it from that perspective. Whether you're hearing it on the radio or whether you're hearing someone here standing here preaching or on the mobile Bible study, or if you're studying the word of God at home, or if you've
being admonished or encouraged by a fellow Christian or a fellow sister, whoever it may be, whenever you encounter the Word of God, there are different ways in which you are going to react to that Word of God. You and I will be different types of soil for that Word of God. Will that Word of God work in our lives or not? It's not only about the new Christian or the person who hasn't obeyed the Word of God yet. To get us in the right frame of mind, have you ever heard this? Have you ever heard someone say, sure, that was an amazing lesson. I just wish you did it on Sunday morning where more people were present. Or I wish you didn't do it on a holiday where everyone was here and they weren't away. Or I wish brother so-and-so was here to hear it. Or I wish sister so-and-so was here to hear it. And you look around and you go, oh, they're not here to hear it. Or, oh, yes, I'm glad they're here. I hope they're listening. Let's watch that they're listening. That's what we do. And subconsciously, sometimes we think when we're going through a passage, we're thinking, sure, you know, Ben really needs to hear this. That's an issue. Okay? And that's what I'm trying to work through this. We may be one of the different soils. In other words, we may be reacting differently. We'll go through that in a little more detail now. And that's why the title of the lesson, sorry, Bruce, is so long. Does the lesson ever apply to me? I really mean that, brethren. Can you sit here this morning and honestly say that sometimes when the lesson is spoken or when the Bible study is delivered, that the lesson applies to you? Can you honestly say that? Or do you and I sit there thinking, never? It's always someone else. You know, it's not really applying to me. I've done everything I need to. Maybe I'm an elder. Sorry, elders, I'm not. Maybe I'm elderly. Maybe I'm accomplished in the faith. So the lesson doesn't apply to me, surely. Yes, it does. It always applies to us, and sometimes it applies more than other times. Because sometimes we realize we may be wrong. Sometimes we need to listen. We need to take note, and we need to apply. It doesn't matter who we are. Matthew chapter 7 verse 24 says, therefore everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. Jesus Christ says to us, when we hear those words and put them into practice, hands up everyone who's put everything Jesus has said into perfect practice. Now raise them, I'm not seeing hands. Right? Because we haven't done everything. And therefore, the lesson can apply to me. We're going to look at the barriers to those. Or does that never really happen? I mean, I need to be honest with myself. Romans 3 verse 23, we know well, says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. James chapter 3 from verse 1 says, not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who is never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check. What does Paul say here? James, rather, say here, not James, but Paul. He says, we all stumble. So he's including himself in that. Everyone stumbles, so everyone has sinned. No one can sit there and go, well, I don't need to listen to a lesson because it doesn't apply to me. That's not necessarily true. So if we're thinking this morning, perhaps we are sitting there going, sure, I won't put my hand up or anything. I'm not that arrogant. I know I'm not perfect, but the lesson doesn't really, I've never really felt the need to change. Never really felt the change. It's those people that have got all these big sins, you know, those that are fornicators and those that are gossiping and those that are murdering and stealing and whatever else they're doing. Those are the people they need to listen and change. We need to change our mindset to listen to the Word of God, whatever level that is. And so let's go to the explanation of the parable of the sower or of the soils from verse 18 in the same chapter of Matthew 13. And it says, hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. That which was sown along the path. For that which was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. And when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for that which was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. For what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, another 60, and in another 30. So we see on this occasion that this parable was told. Jesus told this parable. And then he went back to where, and it actually says into a house, and if you look at Mark, but they, and Jesus then explained the parable only because the disciples said to him, can you please explain this to us? We're not sure what this means. So Jesus explains it to them. Some commentators have split these soils, not differently, but have split them into different names. And I'm going to use that. So these are not my names that I've given it. This is my original work. So I've used these names because I like the context in which it places this passage, and it fits in line with what we're trying to discuss this morning. And the first group of soils, there's four, is the unresponsive heart. The unresponsive heart. And that's the person, and remember our context this morning is not necessarily someone who's hearing the gospel for the first time, but it's you and me. Right? That's who it is. You and me. Maybe it's someone who just refuses to listen. Someone who's callous, whose heart is hard. Someone who casts away the word. Immediately when they hear something from this pulpit or wherever else it is, they just cast it away because their mind just rejects it immediately, right out of hand. Maybe it's the preacher they don't like. This is real. Maybe the preacher, they don't like the preacher or the person speaking. Maybe they don't like what they're wearing. They're focusing on this, or they're thinking, maybe we should get a different color. Or they're thinking about everything else, but they're not thinking about the word because Satan has snatched it away. Satan has distracted them from the message, or us from that message. Can you imagine missing out on something that God wanted to tell you because you didn't like the way in which that message was delivered? Obviously applicable to me. Imagine me missing out on what God wants to tell me because I didn't like the way in which He told me. I can't think of a bigger regret. The enemy Satan snatches that word from us because our heart does nothing with that message. Do we have the wrong attitude? Do we allow these external feelings or emotions to distract us from the message, and therefore we, right out of hand, don't even look at that message? We don't even listen to it. Maybe someone gets up here and starts talking to us about the fact that this is a drive for us in Ashley Gardens. I can speak about it. It's to get our children to Sunday school. I'm sure you get your children to Sunday school. Awesome. But we need to get our children more to Sunday school. And we're talking about it. And maybe right out of hand, when we hear that, we switch off. We go, no, I'm not interested. And then we've rejected that message already. We can't afford to do that. We need to hear and allow the Word of God to penetrate. Otherwise, we won't get anywhere. The second heart is the impulsive heart. And that's the heart that initially receives the word of God with enthusiasm and perhaps emotion, but it's so shallow it doesn't last. Maybe we've even moved to a tear, but it's shallow, it doesn't last. Because as soon as anything happens around us, we are distracted. Perhaps we're too easily inspired. Maybe when we hear a message, we're really worked up. Oh wow, this is an amazing message, and I'm worked up, and I want to serve God. But we react the same way to other messages, to other things, to external stimuli, to things in the world, to video clips or whatever else it is. Not truly the Word of God, something else. And so we're easily influenced. And so therefore, any fad that comes along, we go along with that. We can't stay static. We are influenced by whatever comes along. And then when we have to defend our spiritual position, we simply can't do it. And we fall back into the old. We see this a lot in the charismatic movements, right? Where there's a lot of emotion involved in their services. Wow, the band, everyone's worked up to a frenzy. And those that have done their homework properly actually have their music set to certain tones so that they actually work on your emotions, right? They do that on purpose. But unfortunately, there's not enough substance there to keep people around. And now note this. What I've just said is exactly part of the problem. Because what have I made us do now? of let us focus on how the charismatics hear the word. And so we can all say, oh, the charismatics do this, and they're shallow, and what. The lesson needs to apply to me first and foremost, before we start applying it to other people. Do you see how subtle Satan is? The third one is the preoccupied heart. That's the one that has divided attention. And a lack of faith in what the Bible is really teaching us, a lack of faith in really whether it will work and whether it's applied, leads to failure. And anxiety and worry, and doesn't that just speak to our society today? I mean, I've attended a few insurance lectures in my previous occupation, right at the end of my tenure there, and they were just talking to us about the fact that one of the top 10 risks in the world from an insurance perspective, this is not some little company with all due respect, this is global mega houses that are talking about this, that mental health has now reached the top 10 risk in the world. It's one of the top 10 risks, mental health, from an insurance point of view. Never mind medical aid. Mental health's an issue. People are under duress from wherever, from all sorts of things. And we know where this comes from. But that speaks to us, and that's what happens if we allow that to worry. Imagine if you're hearing the most important thing you could possibly hear this morning. I'm not saying you are, but perhaps you are on some occasion, right? And what you're doing is you're worrying about something that's happening in your life or some stress or some issue. That distracts you and me, doesn't it? We won't listen. We won't apply. It won't be what we get down to at the end, because our attention is divided in that sense. And that could be robbing us of the message that God has for you and for me. And then as this passage teaches us, this soil specifically, that people will chase after wealth and see that is the only outcome, the only solid that they have in their lives. And we know that wealth can be wiped out like that. And you can sit today with something and tomorrow you don't have it. And whatever stock you may be invested, whatever investment you may have, tomorrow the markets can crash. And then if you can't ride it out, you have an issue. Those things are not solid. They're simply tangible. And then the last one is the well-prepared heart. A heart that is not preoccupied, not impulsive, not unresponsive. A heart that is soft and pliable and listens and is able to identify the fact that we have failings, that we're not perfect, and that we make mistakes. That's kind of like in the AA, the first thing you need to do is admit you have an issue. We need to admit that we are not perfect. We need to admit we have a God who is. We need to admit that God brings us through. We're not pathetic humans. That's not how we walk around. But at the same time, we need to be soft and pliable and not hard and impenetrable so that nothing gets through, because that's not going to work. Because that rock, that hardness will break one day, and that's not going to work. That's not going to work out well for us. A heart that is humble, contrite, unassuming. A heart that is keen to improve, to get better every day, to grow spiritually and bear more and more and more and more fruit, not to our honor, but to the honor and glory of God. Isn't it amazing that the character of the hearer determines the effectiveness of the Word of God in their lives? Isn't that amazing? Does the Word of God change? That's wishy-washy. Does the Word of God change? No, it doesn't change. It never does. So the Word of God doesn't change. But the effectiveness in my life depends on my character, my attitude. Isn't that amazing that God has allowed that to happen? We have that quote-unquote power to reject or accept the Word of God in our lives. We can decide, I'm not actually interested. This is boring. I don't want to deal with this. Or we can accept that, deal with it, run with it, and be the best possible human being you could find, and then have heaven waiting for you and me one day, which will blow your mind, blind mind. It's always going to be more awesome than you think or imagine. Always. I've sometimes wondered if I had the opportunity to go back in time, if I had a time machine or something, and I could go back and speak to my 10-year-old self or my 15-year-old self. I see some young ones there. To my 3-year-old self, right? What would I say? Or even to myself yesterday, what would you say? What would you tell that person if you were standing in front of them and you knew this was you at 10 years old or 15 or whatever? What encouragement would you give them? What admonishment would you give them? Would you tell them to listen? I think you would. To listen to good advice. To listen to the Word of God and apply it. You'd probably tell them that it's okay, you will get through this. You'd probably encourage them in some way. You'd probably ask them to change a few things. But one of them would surely be, like I said, and we'd ask them to listen. And I think that that is a very good exercise for us to do in the quietness of our own time. Why? Because we must live in the past and look at that? No. Because that helps us understand the importance of right now. The importance of live, L-I-V-E, not L-I-F-E. Because life is very important, but L-I-V-E is almost more important. What's happening right now in your life is so important. This is what counts, right now. Not all the righteousness and all the sin and whatever that's gone before. Deal with it and then live now. We can't go to heaven on what we did last week. We might go to hell on that if we don't repent. But let's move forward. God wants us to live now. The person who understood that very well was Paul, right? He had to get rid of his past. He said, forgetting what lies behind, Philippians 3 said, and striving towards what lies ahead. That's what he did. That's what we need to do. Perhaps my heart is unresponsive. Perhaps I'm too arrogant to see that I need to change sometimes. And you know the problem there is pride. And my dad preached a sermon once on this, and he said that the original language talks about the fact that when God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble, it's not a passive oppose. It's actually he sets himself up in battle array against those who are proud. That's hectic. God will set himself up against you if you're proud. It's not that he just doesn't like you, your attitude. He actually sets himself up against those who are proud. I'm telling you something. I don't want to be in that camp. When an angel of the Lord can go into the camps of the Amalekites and kill how many thousand? 185,000, just like that. And they turned on one another. No one knew what was going on. That's the power of God. I tell you something, I would rather be on God's side. Perhaps I'm too impulsive, as Ephesians 4 tells us. Maybe I'm just carried away by every wind of doctrine. Everything that happens, I just float along. I can't afford to be that. Is my heart preoccupied? Is it anxious? Am I never content? Do I seek the fulfillment in wealth, in fame and fortune and power? If so, brethren, it's time to change. It's time to see myself clearly in the mirror that is in God's Word. In James chapter 1 from verse 22, the Bible says, but be doers of the Word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at his natural face in the mirror, for he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. For the one who looks in the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in what he does. Because he's put into practice the things that the mirror, the Word of God, has told you and me. Those of you who do mountain biking, I haven't done as much of it recently as I should, and I really want to get back into it. But those who have done mountain biking or any sort of that kind of sport know the importance of a good pair of sunglasses. Why? Because of the sun, but also because of flying objects. Okay? But as you're riding in mud and you're riding everywhere and you've got gloves on and they're full of dust and whatever, you can't clean them. And they get dirtier and dirtier and dirtier and you actually get used to seeing through this maze of stuff. And it's only when you take those glasses off at the end of a ride or at a break and clean them that you're able to see clearly again. If we want to see clearly, then we need to be open to what the message in the Word of God tells us whenever we come across it in whatever format. If you need to respond to this invitation today, in whatever way that may be, please consider these things as we stand together and sing. Sing
this here a sinful man. Make the message clear and plain. Christ receive a sinful man. Come and he will give you rest. Trust him, all his word is plain. He will take the sinful lust. Christ receive a sinful man. Sing it over and over again. Christ receive a sinful man. Make the message clear and plain. Christ receive a sinful man. Now my heart condemns me not. Pure before the law I stand. He who cleansed me from all spot, set his mind its last demand. Sing it over and over again. Christ receive a sinful man. Make the message clear and plain. Christ receive a sinful man. Christ receive a sinful man. Even me with all my sin, purged from every spot and stain, and with him I enter in. Christ receive and over again. Christ receive a sinful man. Make the message clear and plain. Christ receive a sinful man.
Please be seated.
I'm going to be asking Ben to lead us in a closing prayer afterwards, please, Ben. We certainly want to thank Marcell for a fine lesson this morning. And I do believe there's not one person here today where the lesson doesn't apply to them in some way. You know, we certainly, you do get something out of each lesson. But you need to be here to come listen to these lessons. And then apply it to our lives. Every lesson that we hear is certainly something that can change our lives in some way. So it depends on how you look at life and how close you are to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks, Marcell, for coming our way this morning. Thank you to Fred and Ophelia for being with us as well. It's certainly wonderful to see you two with us this morning. Thanks to Theo for leading us in the singing, and to Joseph who led us to the table this morning. Ben, and then we'll be dismissed.
Shall we pray together? Loving and merciful Father in heaven, Father, what a privilege we had this morning to sit around your table. Father, to hear the word preached, Father, from your servant Marcell. We thank you, Father, that we could listen not only, Father, to your word, but listen attentively and to take the word into soft and receptive hearts, as the fourth soil represents, Father, the pliable heart, the heart that is receptive and the heart that is productive. And Father, as the admonition went out this morning, Father, help us, dear Lord, to take your word and to apply it to our lives, Father, and to make it something that is intentional in our lives, to spread the gospel so that your word might be productive and that it might bear fruit 30, 60, even 100-fold. Father, we ask a blessing on the congregation. You know the challenges that everyone faces, Father, especially our elderly, those who recently had surgeries, Father, and those that are going for treatment. We pray, Father, that you'll keep your hand over them. Father, be with our loved ones that are away for the weekend, those that are traveling, Father, and we pray that you'll bring them back safely to us. Father, it was so wonderful to see Brother Fred and Sister Alfreda, along with Marcell and his wife Lucia this morning, Father. We thank you, dear Lord, for the privilege of seeing them again. And we pray, Father, that you'll continue to keep your hand of blessing, your hand of healing over Brother Fred and Sister Alfreda. Thank you, Father, once more for the opportunity this morning to stand and to sit in your presence, Father, and to receive blessing after blessing, Father, from your holy hand. Thank you for Jesus once more who died on the cross and showed us the full extent, Father, of your love, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. As we depart one from another, we pray that you'll bless our trip home, Father. Give us traveling mercies, especially those that are going traveling far. And we pray that you'll bring us back together tonight, Father, to worship you again as you deserve. This is our humble prayer with thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen.